Welcome, everybody. We've got a lot of material we'd like to cover today and probably lay out some touch points and just a list of issues that we hope you'll follow up on and call us if you think you have anything interesting to talk about or any questions. But there is a lot of action and a lot of things happening that we're going to try to go through as quickly as possible in the 75 minutes. And I'm honored to be here with David Harris, Bob Ledig, and Andrew Oranger, who are my co-speakers today for this 75 minutes. So let me launch into a little bit of an introductory overview with regard to some of these topics. I think it's fair to say that we're seeing a huge amount of deregulation occur, and the question always becomes, what is deregulation? Because deregulation has taken on a negative connotation, particularly after some deregulatory moves in various industries have not worked out entirely as expected. I think what I see as deregulation of the financial services here is a move towards practicality and a move, a greater shift towards rationality. And that is one of the things that I think the people who are now running the financial services agency and the Treasury believe is that more regulation is not necessarily good regulation. And it is incredibly easy to get rid of redundant, inconsistent, and ineffective regulations without in any way affecting safety and soundness. And in fact, I expect that what you will see from the people who are running the agencies is less rules and a greater focus on enforcement where there is wrongdoing and greater penalties where there is wrongdoings, because quite frankly, a more effective way of regulating is on a case-by-case basis and with strong enforcement as opposed to the proliferation of lots of rules. Now, the fundamental question that businesses have to contend with in the political environment is what I call the tacking of financial regulation. And that is that unless the regulation is instilled in statutory changes, the likelihood that one administration bounces back and forth from the left and the right in terms of views of regulation is extremely disturbing and an extremely difficult environment to operate in, because you just can't plan for changes that may occur the way they do occur when administrations change and regulations change. So the thing to watch here in terms of permanence is going to be the extent to which statutory changes are made. And I think given the divided Congress we have, I think the prospects for that seem extremely limited. So let's just look at the policymakers who are now in place. And I'll provide you several views which I think are fairly apparent. And that is with the new people at Treasury and the Fed and Joseph Otting as the controller and Helena Williams at the FDIC, just taking those four as the bank regulators, I think you're going to see a tremendous difference in terms of the practical instincts that these people bring to the jobs, because these are people who have been steeped in financial services. They have actually been in the business, and they've actually done things and operated within the confines of the regulation. And so I think you'll find them all extremely practical and extremely interested in removing the redundancies, but not impacting in one way at all the safety and soundness of in the way the financial services are delivered. And I think when we get a final CFPB director, along with Chairman Clayton and Giancarlo and Secretary Acosta, you are going to see the same sort of approach, and that is going to be dovetailing off what the President put in one of his first executive orders, and that is a very cost-effective, practical approach to regulation. And whether we get two regulations pulled back for every one or five regulations pulled back for every one, I think is inconsequential. I think the fundamental point is that these people are practically oriented and understand the business. Now, I think some people might argue that because they come from the business, they will favor it and they will take positions that are not consistent with the public interest. And the only thing I can tell you, and I'm sure anybody who's been a regulator will tell you, is people who are regulators at these high levels are there because they are so qualified and so good at what they do. And when you're good at what you do the best job you can do at the time you have it. And the fact that you came from one place has nothing to do with where you are today and the quality of the job you have to do with it. So I would expect to see nothing but the best from these folks. Let's move to slide 4, Casey. We've been talking about an agenda now for about a year, and been talking with policymakers about this agenda, and I think it's fair to say that this is probably going to look like an agenda that makes some sense to this administration. And that is a few points, and you can see a longer discussion of these in the agenda for reform of the federal regulation of financial institutions that we have published and have included with this webinar and the materials. But I think fundamentally you're going to see a return to principle-based regulation as opposed to rules-based regulation. Principle-based regulation is a lot more difficult because it's easy to write rules and it's easy to enforce rules. The problem is rules are usually ineffective, inefficient, and become redundant and costly. Most importantly, I think you're going to see a complete retake on simplification and transparency of capital, stress testing. In the agenda for reform document, I think we lay out currently 15 capital requirements that apply to large financial institutions, many of which are redundant, and some of which are created with secret formulas that are back office developed at the Federal Reserve Board. And I think what you're going to see is a tremendous push towards transparency and simplification of that process to make it more efficient and effective. Thirdly, I think you're going to see a real close look at the Volcker Rule, which has already started. Fourthly, as I discussed, cost-benefit analysis is going to be a fundamental part of everything that these agencies do. And we'll talk about this a little bit later, a new approach to the regulation of systemic stability. A new approach, I believe, to global harmonization of regulations. And one of the issues that continually comes up and the administration is well aware of is that we continue to be involved in global efforts that at the end of the day result in strict enforcement in the United States and no place else. And I think you'll see some reevaluation of that. We'll talk a little bit later about orderly liquidation and where that's going and if and when that will ever be triggered. And then two critically important issues, cybersecurity and cyber threats. And lastly, the ERISA fiduciary rule and possible SEC action. So there's a lot going on, and I think understanding the philosophies and the dogma that the regulators come to the job with is probably about 70% of the way there in terms of understanding where we're going to end up. I would not hesitate to say, however, that these folks are also going to be very practical, and they're going to try to take into consideration political will and political views from both sides on Capitol Hill to make their jobs a little bit easy and to achieve something that is not so contentious. So along the way, we'll find, I think, some compromise in positions as these issues become articulated into policy. So with that, let me hand it off to Bob.
Said it once and let it stay.
Thank you, Tom. We went through a very contentious election in 2016, during which occasionally the phrase Dodd-Frank would pop up and various protagonists either said it was a great thing or a bad thing. When the election was over and the Republicans wound up in control of the presidency and both houses of Congress, I think there was some expectation there might be a significant rollback of Dodd-Frank during 2017. Now we have the wisdom to see that that did not happen and doesn't appear in any way likely to happen, notwithstanding all the discussion about the pros and cons of the law. One of the interesting things about this whole process here is it really has three heads to it in terms of regulatory reform. The administration, the regulatory agencies, which are mostly independent, at least nominally, and Congress. And to get all those to align in one direction is a very heavy lift, and it's, I guess, part of the beauty of our system in some ways. During 2017, the administration developed a really comprehensive framework for what kind of reforms they were going to try to get in these various venues. And there were a number of really important actions that they took during the course of the year that we will cover during this program. At the financial regulatory agencies, I mean, when you look at what happened in 2017, a lot of it was getting administration appointees into place. And, well, obviously at the CFPB, we've seen that can be a contentious process and maybe even an ongoing process. But once you have administration people at all the agencies, which we will shortly, you suddenly have the possibility of interagency cooperation at levels that you wouldn't have while there were the disparate leaderships that were there. And in Congress, you know, in 2017, the House passed a very broad bill that would have rolled back important parts of Dodd-Frank, which was greeted by very little reaction, if any, from the Senate. And it takes two to tango in this area, so we'll talk some more about the legislative side of things. So now, basically, in place, we have the possibility for 2018 to be a year with a lot of significance in terms of changes. When you look at the administration approach, for an administration that has been extremely controversial and has moved very rapidly in a number of areas, this area is sort of the polar opposite. It is a kind of MIT measured deliberate approach. It all began with an executive order in February 2017 that set out a series of core principles. We've set forth four of the key ones, it seems, in that regard. I'd mention quickly, and Tom noted this about the international side, I think there was a thought that the administration would be very contentious on international matters in the financial regulatory area. And while that may be some part of their plan, it has not yet visited itself that way, and it really has not come through, particularly in the Treasury study. So that's an interesting aspect to keep an eye on. So in that February 2017 order, the Treasury Secretary was directed to consult with the financial regulatory agencies represented on the FSOC. This is a very interesting approach because that meant that they could use, for one time, the FSOC as an excellent way to essentially get independent agencies to report to the President. And as it turned out, the secretary then, of course, has come out with three out of four reports on this topic. And the focus is existing regulation consistent with the core principles, and what is it that needs to be stripped away to make the core principles work? So turning to the Treasury reports, the first one was issued in June 2017 on banks, and then there was a capital markets report, asset management and insurance, and now we are still awaiting a report on non-bank financial institutions and financial technology, Bitcoin, so forth. So on the banking report, which was the first one, there were no particular bombshells in here. And it's interesting, when you read these reports, you might have expected a list of very precise anticipated or requested actions or recommended actions. And there's much more a tone of, well, here's how we kind of see it, and here are some types of things you might want to do. And very seldom saying specific things, often giving two options to move in a particular general area. So a very, very soft sort of focus on things here. On capital and liquidity, that was a major factor. The idea of tailoring applications to risk, which seems to be popular with the regulatory agencies as well, at least they claim it is. The Volcker Rule, a couple of things about the Volcker Rule to address some issues that have continued to gnaw at people. And the idea that the U.S. standards that are placed that place institutions at an institutional disadvantage should be recalibrated. And I would say that's interesting that rather than saying change the international standards, it's live with the international standards and change the U.S. ones that create a problem. The next report was the capital markets report, and there were certain suggestions about getting rid of barriers to raising capital and reducing disclosure requirements. There was an idea of promoting. David Harris.
Hey, Bob. Thanks very much. You were going to try and steal my thunder there, and I couldn't let that happen. But it's interesting, the second report on Treasury capital markets that Bob mentioned was issued in October, and it was followed shortly by the asset management report as well. I'm going to try and highlight a couple of the key points from those reports. They're each several hundred pages long, so we can't get too far into the weeds on them. But they are interesting. They're similar in their structure and approach to the approach reflected in the banking-related report. But they've obviously, given their titles, focus on different aspects of the financial services regulatory environment. In capital markets, the key is sort of enhancing and focusing on improvement to the functioning of the U.S. capital markets. Specific topics that were addressed in the report included, among others, promoting access to capital and investment opportunities, encouraging lending through promotion of quality securitization, recalibrating derivatives regulation, ensuring appropriate oversight of clearinghouses and other financial market utilities, also known as FMUs, and also promoting U.S. interests and promoting a level playing field abroad, again, the international connection. With respect to the access to capital issues, the report had a number of recommendations, including, among others, the removal of certain barriers to raising capital. For example, revising some of the securities offering reform rules to permit business development companies to rely on similar provisions as other 1934 Act issuers that sort of simplify the registration or the offering process. In addition, it recommended some reduction of certain disclosure requirements. A good example in that area are the conflict minerals and pay ratio disclosure requirements that Dodd-Frank had imposed on public company issuers. The report also recommended expanding interesting things like crowdfunding, trying to take advantage of some of the innovations that have evolved over the years to improve the function of the capital markets. Related for those of us who are active in the fund area, including myself, another point of interest is they contemplate or have recommended amending the definition of accredited investor, with the objective of expanding the pool of sophisticated investors. Turning to the securitization area, the report also had a number of interesting recommendations. In particular, they were focused on trying to address the bank capital disincentives to securitization. In particular, a concern being that securitization capital requirements for a securitized product were greater than the capital requirements might have been for the underlying assets. And so the recommendation is to rationalize those requirements between the securitized product and the underlying assets themselves. They also addressed a topic which has been very controversial, dealing with risk retention, and had come up with recommendations to expand those exemptions based on certain asset category characteristics. Interestingly, in that area, there was a decision that came out of the Court of Appeals just last week, which was positive from a security industry securitization perspective for CLO managers in particular, the loan LTSA or LSCI, excuse me for the acronyms, in any event, prevailed in an appeal on the peculiarities in the risk retention rules, which they stretched to extend to the sort of independent CLO managers who bought loans in the market and then securitized them, and the rules and risk retention weren't really set for that. Positive development coming from the courts, not from the regulatory agencies, but still something to be applauded and appreciated. With respect to derivatives, they also had some interesting recommendations, primarily focusing on harmonization. This was focused between CFTC and SEC. As most of you know, they each has jurisdiction over part of the derivatives marketplace, the CFTC with the greatest share and the SEC more on securities-based derivative activities. And one of the complaints of the industry is that the rules aren't always harmonized, and indeed the SEC has been slow in adopting some of the final rules. They also are recommending beyond harmonizing domestically, but harmonizing rules with non-U.S. jurisdiction, including things like focusing on cross-border scope of regulations and rationalizing them with other jurisdictions through, for example, substituted compliance programs. The next topic in the Treasury Capital Markets Report were financial market utilities. Again, this is an area where Dodd-Frank is believed to have increased potential systemic risk because of the requirements that so much be centrally cleared, and the clearinghouses or central counterparties create a new source of potential systemic risk if one of those was to fail. Many people who had participated in transactions cleared for that counterparty would be adversely affected. So one of the recommendations is to enhance the agency efforts to facilitate recovery in the event that one of the central counterparties were to run into financial difficulties. Finally, still in this capital markets area, the theme of the international coordination did come up again. The report recommends that U.S. regulators seek to avoid conflicting or duplicative regulation, but do so through dialogue and what they refer to as outcomes-based, non-discriminatory, substituted compliance arrangements.
Wonder what that means.
I think it probably means whatever works best for us. Non-discriminatory if the U.S. is treated equitably, and outcomes-based is to make sure that it's fair to the industry. A very good question, though, Bob. The report also recommends that participants in the standard-setting bodies actually advocate for and shape international regulatory standards to align with the U.S. domestic considerations. One of those areas is the perception, at least, that in the past the U.S. system has been reactive to what's being developed internationally rather than the international developments being in response to the U.S. driving and trying to influence and shape the form of that regulation. And the goal of this is to sort of reverse that trend to have a more prominent role for the U.S. at least. The next report, the third of the Treasury reports to come out, and we're still waiting for the fourth one, as Bob mentioned, deals with asset management and insurance. Specific topics in that report included ensuring appropriate evaluation of systemic risk and insolvency, promoting efficient regulation and government processes, strengthening U.S. engagement in international forums, again, the international focus, and promoting economic growth and informed choices. Quickly, these topics cover both asset management and insurance components, but we're only going to focus on the asset management component today. In the systemic risk area, the report basically recommends that FSOC not focus on entity-specific issues with respect to systemic risk, but instead look to SIFI designations based upon activities, not actually for designating funds or asset managers as systemically risky, but instead focus on the nature of the risk from the asset management products and activities. More sort of a narrow specific recommendation has to do with the stress testing and the concern that asset managers, investment advisors, investment companies should be subject to similar stress testing as the banking industry has been, that were rejected and recommended that they be repealed. Investment company regulations, another sort of specific topic that was addressed in that context. And here, recommendation is that the SEC adopt a principle-based approach to liquidity risk management rulemaking. As we'll talk about a little bit later, the SEC hasn't quite taken them up on this at this point. They were particularly concerned about some of the bucketing requirements in the current liquidity risk management proposal. The report recommends that the December 2018 implementation date be delayed. To date, there doesn't seem to have been any progress in that. The SEC, at least, has not moved off of that date, notwithstanding requests from the industry. In the area of derivatives, this is another significant rulemaking proposal that had been in part prompted by Dodd-Frank-related concerns. The report recommends the SEC consider a rule to improve the system and require a derivatives risk management program and asset segregation requirement to be implemented, but recommended that they reconsider some of the portfolio limits that had been part of that rule and reconsider the scope of assets that would be eligible to serve as coverage assets for asset segregation purposes. It's an area, as we'll mention a little bit more, there has been a little bit more progress at the SEC in terms of delaying the existing derivatives rule proposal. And finally, in that investment company area, the outstanding business continuity and transition planning as principle-based rules, the answer was that it was not necessary to impose specific ones on investment advisors and investment companies since the principle-based rule is already in place. Other topics quickly to try and keep on schedule, the Treasury Asset Management Report focused on ETFs and the Volcker Rule. In the area of ETFs, the focus has been on adopting a plain vanilla rule that would permit new entrants, new offers of ETF securities to access the market much more readily by effectively simplifying, consolidating the current process, which requires numerous exemptive applications to be passed, and having a simple process that would set up for essentially plain vanilla ETFs to be offered without quite so much difficulty. The Volcker Rule area, I mean, we'll talk a little bit more about that, is one that they also recommended. The regulators seek to refrain from some of the proprietary trading restrictions, particularly in the context of foreign private funds that wouldn't be considered covered funds. This is an area where the non-U.S. fund industry, and even those that are affiliated with U.S. banks, have been particularly concerned because it arguably extends the reach of the Volcker Rule and the U.S. banking laws much further than was intended. So the goal is effectively to come up with a solution to avoid extending the Volcker Rule's restrictions in that area. Similar area of forbearance, there's a narrow rule, fairly technical, dealing with the names of covered funds and the banking entities and restrictions on sharing them, which is somewhat counterintuitive and creates some very anomalous situations. And there's actually been legislation pending and introduced the last couple of years, which would explicitly eliminate that restriction. And finally, there's the whole definition of what constitutes a banking entity and ideas to narrow it down from the current broad reach. In the area of international engagement, the last of kind of the topics that I want to talk about for the moment, again, it's a repeat of the international focus we've seen before. The Treasury Asset Management Report recommends that the U.S. continue to play a leading role at the FSB and IOSCO in an effort to promote transparency and accountability in such organizations. And they encourage them to work with the FSB's Global Systemically Important Financial Institutions, GSIFI framework, to again appropriately take into account the different ways industry participants structure and manage risk.
On that point, David, this is an interesting element. The FSB has said it is coming back after it does the activities-based effort to name GSIFIs in the world of asset managers. And I think the administration will have to decide how much it opposes that, which presumably at this point it would. But that would be a change in FSB policy, which would be significant.
Right. Hopefully if you read this together with the earlier ones about asserting more kind of direction and seeking to shape and align with the U.S. system, that we won't end up backing into globally systemic or global SIFIs, GSIFIs being designated in the asset management space. The last point on this is the term shadow banking has become very prevalent in the press and elsewhere, and it's somewhat in a derogatory sense. It's generally used to refer to participants in the financial services space, particularly those that might be engaged in lending activities that aren't actually a bank. They pick up funds. Money market funds have been considered shadow banks. Private funds that are engaged in direct lending have been considered shadow banks. Any number of entities that aren't subject to the current bank regulatory environment and capital requirements are viewed as shadow banks, and the goal in part seems to be to bring them under a broader bank-like umbrella. And the recommendation here, which is positive, is to move away from that term and hopefully move away from that concept that everybody has to be designated or subject to bank-like regulation in order to protect the financial system. With that, I'm going to let Drew Warringer talk about the last component of the asset management report we wanted to focus on, namely that dealing with the fiduciary rule.
Yeah, thanks, David. The next issue we're going to touch upon relates to the Department of Labor's fiduciary rule under ERISA. ERISA is the statute that comprehensively regulates private U.S. employee benefits, and the fiduciary rule in question here applies only to retirement accounts, like 401k and other pension accounts, and to individual retirement accounts known as IRAs. As we'll discuss later, the fiduciary rule was finalized after a flurry of activity that made it look like the rule at some point might be completely scuttled and never really make it into applicability. One issue was what some viewed as really a usurpation by the Department of Labor of the SEC's area of coverage, that being investor protection. And now there has been much discussion in the market about whether the rule will, or frankly whether it should, survive. If you're wondering about why Treasury might venture into this thicket, it's because of a range of ERISA issues. Implicate the Internal Revenue Code's excise tax provisions, particularly regarding IRAs, where, and this is actually a big point, excise taxes are essentially the only enforcement mechanic for these rules when it comes to IRAs. The Treasury report clearly pushes in the direction of SEC-DOL coordination, further showing the interagency nature of these ERISA questions. And that's really all for now on this piece of the puzzle. More is going to be coming later on this in our presentation, but for now, Bob, back over to you.
Moving on to our next point, just summing this up, the recommendations, as I mentioned, really are just a sort of preferred direction rather than specific action. So far, no, you know, administration 800-page regulatory reform piece of legislation, but I think there will be a lot of communication between Treasury and the agencies during 2018. And a very different, maybe, approach at FSOC. We're going to turn now to Tom on some of the really interesting things that have happened involving SIFI designation and OLA.
Thanks, Bob. And these are two issues that are sort of near and dear to my heart and that we've worked a lot on in the last few years. And perhaps they're a good indication of a train being put in reverse in terms of what the new administration is doing. So with respect to a SIFI designation and the regulation of systemically important institutions, I think there have been a number of arguments that were made over the last 5 or 6 years in the designation process. I know we made these arguments on behalf of several clients, both before the committee and in litigation. And basically, there were four major arguments. One, that what FSOC's doing has got to show some real causal linkage to the required findings under the statute. Two, that in doing that, no agency can speculate, that they've got to look at cold, hard facts and precedents in terms of anticipating systemic problems in the future. So as they did with a number of insurance companies, speculating that there would be a run on life insurance policies was not necessarily backed up by the record. Thirdly was some linkage to a cost-benefit analysis of the costs and the benefits of designating individual companies. And lastly, and perhaps as importantly as any other point, the designation in the record of the actual specific reasons for designation, providing the company with a way out of designation to make the provisions of the statute providing for an annual renewal and annual appeal by the designated parties real. Because unless you know from the record and what you've received from FSOC what the specific reasons are for the designation, you have no idea how to avoid designation and refile for, at your renewal time to in effect, de-designate yourself. And interestingly enough, these are all the points that have been picked up by the administration, by the Treasury in its reports, and by the courts, which now have basically put the designation process in reverse. And all of those have sort of raised the same themes, which are these four themes that I've talked about. And so now, essentially, we have only one remaining SIFI, and that is Prudential Insurance Company. As you know, and we won't spend any time on it here, but the administration has terminated the MetLife appeal, and therefore the underlying decision by Judge Collier stands, which is a terrific decision in terms of substantiating the points that I just went through that people were arguing before the courts and before the FSOC itself. So I think looking at this issue now, I think we're back to square one in terms of what is rational, efficient regulation of the system as opposed to individual financial institutions. And I think we're going to see the agencies and FSOC go back away from designation as an inefficient way of systemic regulation and moving towards reliance upon the underlying agencies to do their jobs in an effective way. And the development of red flags on a global basis that will tell us when the next crisis is coming rather than relying upon the regulation of individual companies to make that determination. I think we'll find that that's probably a far more efficient methodology to use here, and I think one that FSOC will probably tend towards over the next year or so. The other issue that is going to be considered by Treasury at the request of the President and revisited since its enactment in Dodd-Frank in 2010 is orderly liquidation. This is a very, very interesting topic. And for somebody like myself who's approved and overseen hundreds of receiverships and conservatorships, it raises some interesting questions, I think, for the marketplace. And that is, frankly, that orderly liquidation is for the sole benefit of the government and for the sole benefit of the government to control events in a crisis. That may or may not be what we want and what's in the best interest of everyone, but that's what this does. And so it allows the government in an economic crisis to impose economic martial law, which effectively would allow it to seize and put into an FDIC receivership any large financial company, not necessarily a bank and not necessarily a bank holding company, but any large financial company, including a bank holding company or any other financial company that has a impact on systemic stability. And instead of allowing it move towards a bankruptcy proceeding, to put it under a bankruptcy, put it under a receivership with the FDIC. Now that has some interesting implications, none the least of which is that an FDIC receivership, there is no overseeing court, there is no creditors committee, there is no shareholders committee, there is only the FDIC. And for those of you who have followed the 9-year progress of the Washington Mutual receivership, you will know that that in that process, it basically falls to the FDIC to determine who's got a claim, what the value of that claim is, and during that process, no party can enjoin or intervene or interfere with the FDIC through that process. So it is very much an ex parte process dominated by the government, in this case, the FDIC. And the question, I think, that is going to be considered by the Treasury is whether or not that is actually the best route to go. At the end of the day, for all of its expertise in doing 80 years of receiverships and conservatorships at the FDIC, they have never done anything larger than WaMu. WaMu was a $300 billion asset company. basically a very simple business model, deposits funded mortgages. They have never come close to doing anything like a trillion or multi-trillion dollar financial company that would be represented by one of the largest bank holding companies, which up until this point would normally go into bankruptcy if there was a problem. The other aspect of orderly liquidation that is interesting, and I'll stop here, is the way it diverges from precedents. In almost all of the financial crisis since the panic of 1907, the Great Depression, savings and loan crisis, the banking crisis of the early 80s, and the latest financial crisis, the trend has always been to stabilize markets and stabilize large financial institutions as the most effective and the most cost-efficient way of stabilizing markets. What orderly liquidation would require is when one of these large companies is seized, that it be, under law, liquidated. And that, frankly, may be an efficient way of moving forward, but it's not the way we've done it in the past. And the problem I see as somewhat of a financial historian here is that there is no body of evidence, no supporting empirical work, and no precedents to suggest that that's the best way to handle financial failures and financial distress in the future. So we'll be interested to see what the Treasury puts in its report on the future of orderly liquidation and whether or not it recommends its repeal. We've yet to see it used, but I assume in the next financial crisis we will see it used, and we'll see some of the things I just talked about played out in the real markets for the first time. So I think watch for that Treasury report, because it could have an impact on everybody to the extent that it has an impact on markets. Because if companies that have previously been subject to bankruptcy and the rules of bankruptcy and the waterfall in bankruptcy are now subject to an FDIC receivership, that could result in some price adjustments in the marketplace that will affect everybody. So let me move on. David Harris.
Thanks, Tom. We're going to turn now and start focusing a little bit on some of the second leg of the three levers in the area of financial reform, the administrative agencies. First one we're going to focus on is the OCC, the Office of Comptroller of the Currency. Interestingly, it's been one of the leaders, particularly in the area of the Volcker Rule, and that's in part perhaps because it is a division of Treasury and is therefore directly part of the administration, unlike most of the other financial regulators, which are independent agencies. In any event, specifically, the OCC's taken the lead with respect to potential changes to the Volcker Rule regulations. As early as last summer, when the OCC was still under the head of an interim director or interim comptroller, acting comptroller, they proposed or issued for comment to the industry a request for comment on what changes, if any, should be made to the Volcker Rule to make it more efficient and achieve the purposes of the statute. Four topics or four areas were asked to be focused on. They include the scope of the entities that should be subject to the Volcker regulations, the scope of the proprietary trading restrictions, scope of the covered fund restrictions, as well as the requirements for compliance program and very detailed metric requirements. In that four areas, they laid out 25 questions they wanted the industry to comment on. A fair number of people did actually comment. The comment period ended last fall. They made some interesting recommendations, which have yet to be acted on, although we do hear that the OCC continues to be active in trying to coordinate with the other agencies a response to some of these. And hopefully we will see in the not-too-distant future some more concrete evidence of where they're heading with the Volcker Rule amendments. Specific comments worth mentioning include one is to, consistent with the overall theme of a lot of the financial reformists, to remove the most onerous requirements from applicability to the smaller banks, the smaller participants in the marketplace. In this case, they also recognize that many of the banks that are involved are non-U.S. banks, and for purposes of determining their size, even though they may be huge on a global basis, to the extent they have a limited U.S. presence, it's the size of the U.S. presence which would determine whether they were eligible for the smaller bank exemption. Another area that received a lot of attention is the definition of proprietary trading, and the industry was recommending, or the commenters recommended, that it should focus really on what is true, that is really viewed as standalone speculative trading, principally for selling in the near term. The underlying theme here is that the current structure of the proprietary trading definition effectively presumes that any transaction in financial instruments is going to be proprietary trading unless there's an exemption available. And the idea is to reverse that presumption and say it only applies if you demonstrate that it is for short-term proprietary trading. Similarly, with respect to the scope of the covered fund definition, recommendations were to narrow that so that it really only engaged in recovered or picked up funds that were engaged primarily in short-term trading, short-term proprietary trading. Another way people have characterized this is that they use the terms hedge fund and private equity fund as is the definition, and in particular in the hedge fund area, the perception is that if you're an active trader in securities for your hedge fund, then that would be covered. But if you're engaged in other activities that aren't primarily the short-term proprietary trading, looking to take advantage of short-term market movements, it shouldn't be subject to those restrictions. Again, going back to one of the topics we noted earlier, the naming prohibition continues to vex many in the industry. You can't have a bank, even though it has an investment advisor who's a banking entity whose name is the same as the fund's name, even if it's not the same as the bank's name, the concern being that that restriction is overreaching and unnecessary to protect the bank from potential exposure to the trading activities of the fund. And finally, they also commented, received comments about non-U.S. funds that are actually excluded from the definition of covered fund, and I think they should similarly be excluded from being treated as banking entities under most circumstances. Turn it over back to Bob to talk about another OCC development of interest.
Well, you know, one thing that's been popping up increasingly, obviously, is the area of Bitcoin and crypto currencies and technology advances and so forth. And the OCC launched an initiative in 2016 to aggressively encourage the use of fintech in the banking sector, and in that it has had a program of meeting with fintech companies and financial institutions interested in getting into the sector. I think for Tom and I, this is reminiscent of a period in the late 90s where that was similarly a very popular topic, but this is a new round. In this regard, the OCC had suggested that it was willing to grant special purpose national bank charters to non-deposit-taking fintech companies with regulation tailored to their particular circumstances. The state banking authorities who generally regulate financial activities that are not national banks or federal SNLs did not see this as a good development, and I think considered the possibility that a lot of their folks might wind up heading over to the OCC, which then triggered a lawsuit by the New York Department of Financial Services, and that suit was recently dismissed on the grounds that the OCC really hadn't done anything actually to move this process forward, and it was not sufficiently ripe. There's also a suit by the Conference of State Banking Supervisors that remains pending. And now I turn it over to Tom, who's going to discuss the Federal Reserve Board developments.
Thanks, Bob. Let me just add one point on the Bitcoin and cryptocurrency phenomena, because there is one question that came in about what the likely future of regulation of them is. And Bob rightly points to a period back between 1996 and 2000. I was the chair of the American Bar Association's Cyberspace Law Committee, and we conducted several projects there dealing with Mondex, DigiCash, and then released a 20-country report on jurisdiction in cyberspace. And the one thing that almost every country and every regulator was pretty focused on at that time, because of DigiCash particularly, which was an anonymous currency, was that there's no way that they would let those things proliferate. because without a central bank or a government protecting them, eventually they're a disaster waiting to happen. Now, I thought that was a little bit conservative, but it was the views expressed at that time in this country by FinCEN, the banking regulators, and Treasury. And here we are now, some 15, 20 years later, and I think the markets and the regulators are saying, let's see where this market innovation goes, and let's see what risks it produces. But I think looking at history of these kinds of things, to the extent that they actually become a working currency, that I think what will happen is the larger the mass appeal, the more regulation they will eventually garner. And that's just the way I think things happen. But I think at the moment, most policymakers are willing to see where it goes and what it is. And I think as, again, you'll see greater regulation and greater consideration of regulation as mass appeal and mass use increases. One point on Federal Reserve Board developments, I think what the administration has in mind with respect to the Federal Reserve Board and what I think probably Vice Chairman Randy Quarles is thinking about a lot is how to simplify and make some of the rules a little more realistic in a very practical sense. I think we'll see small bank changes in terms of capital simplification. I think you'll see some reevaluation of resolution planning and living wills. I think both sides, both large financial institutions and the Fed and the FDIC, agree that there is a value to living wills. I think the question of the breadth and depth of that value is up for grabs. And I'm reminded of one large bank that filed a living will of 16,000 pages with its regulator on Wednesday and was asked to discuss it with the regulator on Thursday. So you tell me how much of that, you know, was really read and digested. In the same regard, there's a lot of tension and a lot of concern about the transparency of stress testing, and I know that's an issue that the Fed is taking up and is going to work on, and I think we'll probably move in the direction of greater transparency, but not complete transparency. Leverage ratios and the Volcker Rule, as we've talked about, are important areas for recalibration. And then finally, I think you'll see an increasing trend that we've seen over the years, and that is tailoring regulation to size, risk profile, and business model, which seems to make enormous sense because at the end of the day, a $100 million bank and a $1 trillion bank are both banks, but I think no regulator believes that they should be regulated in anything that looks similar to each other. So I think that trend will continue as we move along here in this environment with changes from this administration. So let me hand it back now to David Harris.
Thanks, Tom. We're going to focus for a few minutes on the SEC initiatives. It is, again, one of the independent agencies, and it's only now become fully staffed with a full slate of commissioners within the last couple of weeks. The remaining commissioners were sworn in. As mentioned in the earlier discussion of the capital markets report, there's been kind of a interesting comparison, depending upon what the proposal is and where it was in the rulemaking process, as to how the SEC has responded to some of the suggestions and recommendations in the Treasury capital market reports. The area of liquidity risk management, which was the furthest along in the rulemaking process, had been formally adopted before the Treasury report came out, had an implementation date set for December 2018. That one, they have yet to follow up on the recommendations from the Treasury to delay implementation of the rule. There's still hope in the industry that they may at some point do so, because it's an extremely complicated rule with a whole set of highly data-intensive requirements that are being imposed for the first time on the industry, and it will require a significant amount of time and effort, and many are probably not even prepared. The ICI, as a trade association, has continued, and fairly recently urged the SEC to delay implementation by at least a year in terms of additional time. By contrast to that proposal, with respect to the derivatives proposed rule, the SEC is it was not as far along in the rulemaking process. They had proposed a derivatives rule to codify some of the existing interpretive guidance and rationalize it and add a number of additional requirements. It received a lot of negative comment from the industry in terms of the additional limitations it proposed to impose on the fund industry. And it was still in the process of reconsidering and perhaps reissuing a new proposal in that area when the Trump administration, or when President Trump was elected last November, and things had been kind of put on hold. And significantly with respect to the Treasury report, what had been originally projected for final approval in April of 2018 has been dropped from the SEC's regulatory agenda for this six-month period. Similarly, with respect to the investment advisor business continuity and transition plans, where the proposal was issued in July 2016, again, before the election, but they had not been acted upon at that point, that too has been removed from the SEC's regulatory agenda. Other things that they are focused on, and consistent with our earlier discussions about the whole cryptocurrency blockchain related activities, both the SEC and CFTC in the last few weeks have been active both with enforcement actions, with suggestions, disclosure guidance, all kinds of things, and emphasizing the importance of this area and how seriously they're taking developments and how close an eye they will be giving to efforts to offer, whether it's initial coin offerings, the proverbial ICO, or not treating some of those offerings as securities offerings subject to the securities rules or commodities products subject to the CFTC's rules. And finally, as an aside, they do indicate that they do intend to finalize those Dodd-Frank required rulemakings, mostly with respect to securities-based swaps that have been lingering on the SEC shelf due to other priorities. At this point, I think it's back to Drew to talk a little bit about the Department of Labor.
Yeah, thanks, David. So I'm generally a context guy. And here I think context regarding the fiduciary rule is particularly important, so I'd like to focus a bit on how we got to where we are. This is really interesting, I think, in terms of watching the Trump administration trying to understand what's really necessary when it comes to making regulatory changes. So what happened here? You start with the original fiduciary regulation under ERISA, which had been in place for almost 40 years, really since ERISA itself became law. Interestingly, the DOL has long disliked its own rule. They have not liked what they did as time went on, viewing it as really too favorable to the advisor community. And then when President Obama got elected, the dynamics within the DOL really made it possible for them to go after the fiduciary rule, and go after it they did with a vengeance. Frankly, and this is important here in terms of what's happening now, they got tired of waiting around for the SEC to do something, and they just went ahead and acted. They proposed an expansive new rule and even captured investors, IRA investors, individual retirement accounts, over which they really have no direct jurisdiction. The proposal became a lightning rod for criticism, and eventually, and this is really unusual, it had to be withdrawn. And then President Obama himself went out in support of the rule, and the rule was reproposed. After more controversy and against some steep odds, the rule was finalized. Now, they knew they had an election coming up with all of the variables that that could bring, right, to say the least, a couple of variables there with the new election. And so they pushed to get this thing finalized and at least nominally effective before the election. Even though the rule wouldn't have any initial applicability until after the election, they were getting it finalized before the election. And now it's tricky, but as we'll see, it's a maneuver that may indeed have actually saved the rule, at least for now. And you can flip the slide to 28. So after the election, the question was, would the rule survive? Now, first you had the Priebus memo in early 2017, if you remember that. That's shortly after Trump took office, which generally froze all regulations that were not yet effective. But the fiduciary rule was effective. It just wasn't applicable yet. And that's what I was referring to earlier when I referred to the rush to get the rule effective before the election. Pretty clever. This question of delayed applicability really was considered to be key because there was a widespread feeling that with any kind of delay, the Trump administration would more easily be able to kill the rule altogether, as seemed to be what they wanted to do. Nevertheless, and so the rule did seem to be in some trouble. Early on, you had Anthony Scaramucci, if you remember him, at the time pretty big in the emerging Trump administration, comparing the regulation literally to the Dred Scott decision from the Supreme Court back in the days of yore, a pro-slavery decision by the Supreme Court. I mean, you just can't make some of this stuff up. On February 3, 2017, a draft presidential memorandum circulated with principles against which the fiduciary rule would be judged. But the final memorandum contained guiding principles. It did not contain an extension. Now, and this is sort of the process point I wanted to make. I don't pretend to have been in the room, so to speak, but it does seem fairly possible to me that at the 11th hour, the administration better came to understand the difference between killing a rule that hasn't yet become applicable and waylaying something that's implemented and in some sense effective. And the ability to waylay something that's effective is much more daunting. So later in the same day, there did come a short but coordinated press release from the Department of Labor saying that the DOL would soon be proposing an extension. Now the Trump administration seemed to be really focused on process. And just for emphasis, the acting chair of the SEC back then piled on several days later, absolutely ripping into the rule in a widely reported speech, and we'll come back to the SEC soon. So, game over, rule dead, that's sort of what it may have looked like. Well, maybe not. In particular, guess what? During this phase, there was no labor secretary. The initial nominee was controversial and withdrew. An approval of the eventual labor secretary, Alexander Acosta, was delayed for the Gorsuch confirmation. And so you say, well, so what? Well, the so what is how this thing unfolded. At worst, there was room for DOL officials to maneuver the rule towards survival. And at best, there was just a whole lot of confusion. And ultimately, an extension was finalized, but here's the thing. The way they did it, the extension for the basic regulation expired on June 9th, and the regulation did become applicable on that date. And so the final ultimate punchline is one that a lot of people really didn't see coming. The rule, at least for now, does live. And the rule has had a real impact, to be sure. For example, the market has moved towards extremely unfortunate documentation, under which providers who might worry that they're fiduciaries try to confirm that they're not acting as fiduciaries under the rule. If you ask me, it's really quite a pity. But there have been other extensions since the election, and the current state of play is that while the basic rule is effective, is applicable, the guts of the so-called best interest contract exemption, or the BIC exemption, a key part of the DOL's rules, have been put off until July of 2019, which in this context is basically forever. Right now, all that's left of the BIC exemption is an extremely high-level requirement to act in the customer's best interest. And consistently what Tom said about principle-based rulemaking, there really are few, maybe even almost no specific requirements currently in place under the BIC exemption. Also, and I want to get this point out there, I know this is going to sound wrong to many of you on the call, IRA owners have absolutely no claim under the rule that the provider has violated fiduciary duties. No claim. The only risk under the rule is that Trump's IRS will assert a claim for excise taxes. Now, that may surprise some of you. We just don't have time in this session to get into this aspect of it here. And anyone that wants to hear my thoughts on this can email or call me, I think as Bob mentioned early on, or maybe Tom. I'm happy to walk through my thinking with any of you that are interested in this point. Anyway, things may not be as bad as some may have thought because of the combination of the extensions and the way things were finalized. And we'll just have to see how it all plays out. And you can move the slide now to 29. In terms of the process, there are some lessons here, I think. To me, the Trump administration learned that process really does need to be attended to and followed, and then they learned that when no one's minding the store, the process actually can get away from you a bit. So anyway, then, where are we now at this juncture? Okay, first, will there be more on the administrative side? Almost surely, yes. At a minimum, it seems almost impossible that the BIC will ever become fully applicable as presently written. Clearly, the DOL is going to be doing more, at least if you ask me. Will the rule be legislatively repealed? Well, you're going to hear more about the Choice Act in a minute or two, which does have a repeal provision in it for the fiduciary rule, But to be honest about it, I'm not sure anybody's really counting on legislative repeal at this point. Could happen. I don't think people are counting on it. Will the SEC act to adopt a broadly applicable best interest standard coordinated with a maybe somewhat more streamlined DOL rule? Well, that actually is my guess as to where this is all going to come out. I mean, we'll have to see, but that's my guess. The current indications are that the SEC's and the DOL's focus will be on harmonization, integration, and consistency, but using an approach that will fall short of totally conforming the SEC and DOL rules or otherwise making them identical. I think David mentioned this notion of harmonization and consistency, and I think that's what we're going for here. Right now, you've got a DOL rule that just stands out there really like a sore thumb in terms of the regulatory environment generally. Now, if that's right, the Department of Labor rule will, to some extent or another, survive this little passion play, but we'll have to see just in one form. Well, that's really it for me on the fiduciary rule. There we are. I'm sort of reminded of the curse of Confucius. May you live in interesting times. And with that, Bob, I'm going to hand it back to you.
Drew, thank you very much. Enjoy spending these interesting times with you and Tom and David. The congressional development side, the third leg of our stool here, on the Congress side in regard to the House of Representatives, there was a broad rollback of Dodd-Frank contained in a very, very long bill called the Financial Choice Act. That bill was approved on a party line basis in June. You know, it would have really cut back on FSOC, including no more SIFI designations. It would have gotten rid of OLA and modified the bankruptcy code for the joy to many people, would have repealed the Volcker Rule, but that's another element, and would have created the off-ramp from regulation for institutions that had high levels of capital, which really would have been quite a departure from the last 20 years of bank regulation. As Drew mentioned, it would repeal the fiduciary rule, and it would have also gotten rid of certain of the authorities of the CFPB. So all that was very exciting, except that as we go to the next slide, really no indication the Senate Republicans had any maybe the word is stomach to push for enactment of the Financial Choice Act. As a practical matter, you need 60 votes for really significant and controversial legislation. Democrats are generally opposed to the rollback of Dodd-Frank, and so pretty much that takes us to a development in December, when the Senate Banking Committee approved a bill, the Economic Growth Regulatory Relief and Consumer Protection Act. A lot of these financial institution laws have a lot of names in them. And that was on a 17-6 vote, which you'll note is quite bipartisan. And it was generally the provisions dealt with relief for community banks, including Volcker relief. But one thing for larger institutions would have pushed up the enhanced prudential standards threshold from $50 billion to $250 billion, generally speaking. And, you know, you can see the possibility that if people want to put together a broader bill that might include some aspects of the Financial Choice Act, the combination of this bill, which seems like it might be able to have enough support to get through the Senate and the Financial Choice, could theoretically, in some world, lead to a very interesting conference committee session. And now I'm going to turn to David.
Very briefly, another interesting congressional development that touches upon the asset management industry in particular kind of came a little bit of a surprise to many people, I think, which has to do with essentially the money market fund reform initiatives. As most of you probably recall, after the financial crisis or during that, one of the money market funds broke the buck, the reserve fund, that led to a substantial amount of assets fleeing prime funds and moving into government funds. Treasury provided a guarantee for a limited time period of money market fund assets, and all of that led to lots and lots of outcry for reform of the money market fund industry. It was a back-and-forth process with the SEC at the time under Chair White having proposed an initiative that the industry opposed quite a bit. and ultimately did not move forward with that proposal. A revised version came back that essentially is what has been in place since 2016. It does require that prime funds that are sold to not to retail investors but institutional investors have to have a floating net asset value. That created issues, a lot of money, probably around $1 trillion, I believe, is what the numbers I've heard, moved out of the prime funds and into government funds because of unwillingness to stay in a product that would have a floating NAV, unlike the traditional money market fund that had a constant NAV. In any event, the war seemed to have been won by the reformists, and life moved on after 2016. But one of the major players in the industry, Federated Investors, continued to work with, and I think was supported by the many state treasurers who find the lower returns in the government money market fund much less attractive and much more disadvantageous from their state treasury perspective, pushed for, or encouraged Federated to push for legislative developments to, in essence, put back the constant NAV option for prime funds. And that's what this Consumer Financial Choice and Capital Markets Protection Act 2017 would have done. It is bipartisan, and again, that reflects the support from the state treasurers largely, and has been considered by the Senate. The early indications that it might actually move forward seem to have been delayed. The ICI investment company industry and some of the other major money market fund providers have come out opposed, thinking that it's much cost and extra effort when they've already accommodated to the new regime, and would just as be happy sticking with the existing rules. So, in a nutshell, that's what's going on with that particular piece of legislation. It remains to be seen whether it ultimately passes or not. But for now, I'm pessimistic.
Okay. Well, then we quickly talk about the Congressional Review Act, which goes all the way back to Newt Gingrich's contract either with or for America, or on America, depending on your preference, and had only been used one time to void a rule until a flurry that occurred here in early 2017 where 15 rules were voided, including notably the CFPB's arbitration rule, on a very, very narrow vote. So basically, depending on how the agencies and Congress are aligned at any given time, this either is an important tool or not. But we see that when you had a Democratic administration having done a lot of rules in the last year and Republicans getting energized to use this this tool, used it over and over again, and many more were proposed as well. So the other part of this is, in a sort of stunning development after 20 years, the congressional, the GAO gave an opinion saying that essentially guidance, agency guidance, is equivalent to a rule and has to, well, a rule for purposes of this law. Rule is a very, very fungible term depending on where you're operating, but has to be submitted to Congress, and the agencies had not been doing this, or many of them had not been doing this for their, quote, guidance. And the GAO says the fact you don't have to publish something for notice and comment and it's not binding doesn't exclude it from the coverage of the rule. This came up in the context of the leveraged lending guidance as well as the CFPB's indirect auto lending guidance. And so there's a bit of a quandary in the industry. People don't like rules that that don't have notice and comment, but they also like having guidance. And so the question will be what, how are the existing rules that are subject to this handled, and how will the agencies deal with this in the future? And so at this point, we have one more topic. I'm going to turn it over to Tom on GSE reform.
Thanks, Bob. And let me just underscore what Bob just said, because the whole phenomena of the return of the Administrative Procedure Act, I think, is part and parcel of sort of the cycle of regulation. I have a particular fondness of the whole area since One of my first jobs at the Comptroller of the Currency back in the late 70s was defending rules in court that were challenged under the APA. And those challenges used to happen fairly routinely as agencies issued regulations. For some reason, that stopped being the normal course of events where trade associations and institutions themselves challenge the rules. And it's not until the last 5 to 7 years, and I think that's particularly because of Dodd-Frank and the reaction to Dodd-Frank, that the phenomena has arisen once again of numerous challenges to regulations under the Administrative Procedure Act. And the LSTA decision, the MetLife decision, a number of those decisions sort of underscore that the government can be wrong and that the government can be rolled back using the Administrative Procedure Act. So those who know the Administrative Procedure Act and work under it know that that while it's a tough case to bring, where there are deviations from the statute, and you can go under a statutory argument as opposed to an arbitrary and capricious, you've probably got a better argument. So let me end this with a short discussion of GSE reform. As you know, Freddie and Fannie, you've been in conservatorship since September 2008, and there has been increasing discussion on and off over the years, and particularly now, given the new administration, on how to get them out of conservatorship. And, of course, the question of how to get them out of conservatorship raises the question of, well, what do we want the new housing finance system and the secondary mortgage market to look like? And if you're following along, you know that there's upwards of about 12 different groups that have submitted plans for what their aspirations for what they think the new housing finance program and Fannie and Freddie or Fannie and Freddie look-alike should look like in this new environment. And most of those aspirational documents, I think, skip one important issue, and that is how we get from here to there, which is not an insignificant fact, given that Fannie and Freddie are in conservatorship. They were never put into receivership, which means they have a public ownership still in place, and that's a significant issue in terms of moving from here to there. Senator Corker has been active in the area. He's working on legislation which has been leaked in the last week or so. It is a significant piece of legislation talking about moving from Fannie and Freddie to five or six guarantors backed by their own capital, Ginnie Mae, and then the full faith and credit of the United States, as well as a mortgage insurance fund that provides an explicit guarantee to the securities and not to the company guarantors. There are embedded subsidies for affordable housing and a wide range of new changes, but again, not speaking to the issue of how we get from here to there in terms of the markets and what the market's expectations will be. The one thing that I would say in closing on the GSE reform is there's a lot of suggestions about the need for legislation. To those who have been arguing that we need legislation to the move to the next plateau, I would just say sit down one night with a glass of wine and read HERA, the Housing Economic Reform Act of 2008, because that's where Congress laid it all out and gave the FHFA all the power it needs, working with Treasury, who's the senior preferred shareholder here, to in effect go to the next plateau without legislation. And that's an important factor, given that the likelihood of legislation out of a highly divided Congress is not high. And so at the end of the day, administrative solutions can work here, and hopefully the administration will wind its way through its patience in terms of the legislative process and move towards more practical administrative solutions, which I think at the end of the day make a lot more sense in a market-oriented way. So I think that sort of covers all the points we wanted to cover, and I apologize for the rapid-fire way that they've come at you, but we simply wanted to lay down markers here in terms of the issues that we think are under consideration and where the world and the administration, the regulatory agencies are going to go. And with that, I think unless there are any questions, we will end it, but I don't know if we've gotten any further questions. So, Casey, do we have any questions?
No, we're good to go.
Okay. Well, I think we've expended our time and hopefully not your patience, but in any event, thank you very much for your attention, and we'll talk to you the next time.